Sorry.
That's all right. So I wanted to share with you how I came upon the story that inspired exile music. Well, the many stories that inspired exile music. It wasn't just one. And tell you a little bit about the book and the research that I did for the book over the 5 years that I was working on it. So as Jeffrey mentioned, in 2012, we moved to La Paz, Bolivia, and we had never been to Bolivia before. So it was an entirely new environment for us. And also, as Jeffrey mentioned, my husband had come home from a meeting with the honorary Austrian consul one day to tell me that there were close to 20,000 Jewish refugees in Bolivia during World War II. And I hadn't realized that. I'd read a lot about Jewish refugees in other parts of South America, but I didn't know about.
Sorry, Jennifer, excuse me.
That's all right. Pretty photo.
Yeah, I know, but Joanne, I think Joanne.
Yeah.
You have set up your, you hit share screen by accident. So you need to stop your share screen, sorry. And go ahead, Jennifer, thanks.
That's all right. I thought, well, I want to learn more about this part of the diaspora, which I wasn't aware of. And I started looking around for books to read, and there were very few. There were some great memoirs. There's a beautiful memoir by Leo Spitzer called Hotel Bolivia. I don't know if some of you, maybe Blima is nodding. Yes, I mean, Blima, probably a lot of this may be familiar to you. Blima's in Brazil, so not too far away from Bolivia. So after I'd heard this and I wasn't able to find too many books, I got the memoirs and started reading them. But in the meantime, I met John Galerter. Now, John Galerter, his parents come from a part of Poland that was taken over by Ukraine and then the USSR, and then Ukraine again, I think. And every single person in their village was murdered, including their two-year-old daughter and their parents. And John's mother and her husband, who had escaped from conscription in the Russian army, managed to flee first to Paris and then to Bolivia, because by 1938, I'm sure many of you know, Bolivia was one of only three countries still offering visas to Jews fleeing Europe. So I met John, and he's a musician. He's a violinist. He's a concertmaster. He conducts. He played and conducted the first Bolivian orchestra, which started in 1945. And so John told me his family story, and which was fascinating in and of itself. And then he started telling me what it was like to grow up in La Paz as a Jewish person from Europe, although he was born in La Paz. And I'm sure also some of you may know that Klaus Barbie was living in La Paz and elsewhere in Bolivia for a time. And John told me about how he would sometimes run into Klaus Barbie on the street and what those encounters were like. And I thought, why hasn't anyone written about this? Because I was thinking about, you know, the trauma of having lost everyone you love and all your home and everything you own in your career, and then traveled all the way across the world to La Paz, which is at 12,000 feet or 4,000 meters, depending on how you measure, and can be quite challenging for that reason alone. But these people were arriving in a country where they didn't speak the language and they didn't understand the cultures, and they're in the middle of the mountains where it's difficult to breathe. And I thought, that's traumatic enough. And then just imagine what it's like when the Nazis start showing up and you're like, wait a minute, I just traveled so far away, only to be confronted with you again. And so I started thinking, well, these stories have to be told. I want to know more about this part of the diaspora. I think it's really important that there be more written about the experiences of these people. And so I started doing a lot of research. And because my friend John was a musician, I wanted to make my main characters musicians, but I also wanted to make them musicians because when I write books, I tend to want my characters to do things that I can't do, but that I'd very much love to be able to do, because it allows me to live vicariously through them. So I made my characters musicians, and then when I decided where, so my family is the father, Jacob. He plays violin with the viola with the Vienna Philharmonic. His wife is an opera singer, Julia, and they have a daughter and a son. The daughter's name is Orly. She's around 10 when the book starts, and she's my protagonist. She has a beloved older brother named Willie. So when I started researching the Vienna Philharmonic, I was horrified by the way that orchestra has behaved for a very long time. They not only employed Nazis, even when it was illegal to be Nazi, but they then expelled all the Jewish musicians that played for the orchestra, and sent them either to the concentration camps or into exile in other countries. And some of these musicians were not even exactly sure where their bodies ended up, where they are. And so I learned all of their names in the course of my research, and it was really important to me that I got them into the book somehow. So at least their names would be there, these musicians who played there. I mean, the Vienna Philharmonic continued to employ Nazis until 1967. And that was a little piece of information that I had been unaware of before I started writing the book. And then that immediately created conflict, because here I have this father playing alongside people who want him dead. And what's that like to show up for work in an orchestra every day and be in that situation? And the mother, you know, is not getting as many jobs, you know, in the 1930s as Hitler rises to power. And so eventually, like so many, they were trapped in Vienna and couldn't get visas anywhere, didn't have connections in the US, and finally had the opportunity to go to Bolivia. So they end up traveling to Bolivia. The son ends up leaving first via Switzerland. He ends up in Switzerland. And so the three others travel without them. So I wanted to also write about, I was very interested in writing about resilience and how people find a way through trauma, because this has always fascinated me, because there are people who have experienced such horrific things and are somehow still standing and still leading happy lives. And there are others who can't recover and don't have the emotional resources to recover. And so I'm interested in the things that help pull us through these traumatic times. And I think the arts are often those things. For this family, it's music. And so in my book, music plays a different role in how each character adjusts to their new life in Bolivia. So for example, Orly's father, Jacob, he's played the viola. So he can't imagine not playing. Playing the viola is like speaking to him. He plays the viola almost every waking minute of his life. And so when he's in Bolivia, the obvious thing for him to do is to teach. But at the same time, he's learning from his Bolivian students and learning new instruments and learning new songs. And he's freed from the same repertoire he's been playing for many years and suddenly realizes there's so much more out there in music. And so music helps him connect, you know, the music of his homeland to the music of his adopted homeland. And that's kind of how he keeps going, as he uses music. And the mother, who's the opera singer, having left her son behind in Europe, she can't sing any longer. And she stops singing, because singing not only requires her to be, even if she's singing a sad character, I feel like singing always comes from a place of joy, that joy that you can sing. Even if you're expressing sadness, there is a joy in the making of music and with your body and singing it. And I feel like it's different from playing an instrument that's outside of your body. And in her case, she didn't feel the joy that was necessary for her to sing any longer. And so she ends up falling into depression, but she also ends up getting her family into a lot of trouble. I'm not going to give away any spoilers, because I'd love for you to read the book one day. And Orly, of course, is young when they go there. So she's the most fortunate in that young people, I've been moving my daughter to a different country every 3 years since she was born. And so I've watched her adapt to many countries and learned a lot from that. And the younger you are, the easier it is to adapt. And I watched, you know, my daughter was almost three when we moved to Bolivia and within weeks was speaking Spanish, whereas she's now 13 and very difficult to move. Now that she has her own ideas about where she would like to be. So over the years I spent researching this book, I researched all the, time is flying. I researched the music of the period, not only the classical music that Jacob would have played, but all the popular music that the children would have known. I also read all the books. I read many of the books that my characters would have read that would have been published in German at that time, so that I feel like the books that we read contribute to who we are as human beings. And so I felt that it was important that I read the books my characters had read to better understand the things that shaped them. It also occurred to me when I was first writing the story that perhaps, you know, I have a journalism background. So I thought perhaps I should write this as a nonfiction book. My first book was nonfiction and I could have reported out this story and found live survivors, which I did. I met many survivors in La Paz and talked to them, but there was a lot they didn't remember because they were much older and didn't recall everything and were missing a lot of details that I would have needed to bring a scene to life. And I thought, well, what I'd like to do is create a very well-researched and believable context for this story that anyone who lived through this experience would recognize. But I'm gonna create a fictional story and characters because that way I can fill in the gaps that will allow the reader to empathize with these characters and see them as whole humans. I won't be missing chunks of the story because I'm making up their story. But my goal was to make it so that survivors who had lived through this time recognize themselves. And 2 weeks after Exile Music was first published, I got an email from a man in Florida who was 90 years old. And he said, I just finished Exile Music and it is so close to my own experience that I cannot believe you made it up. And that was the best fan mail I ever could have received because it meant that he felt I had done justice to his story. And since then I've talked to a lot of other survivors who lived in Bolivia during that time, grew up in Bolivia or passed through Bolivia. Not everyone stayed. A lot of people left after the war. Some people are still there, but it's a much smaller group. I also did a lot of research, of course, into the Bolivian aspects, you know, the Bolivian holidays. We lived in Bolivia for 4 years, so I had a fair amount of time to get to know that country and experience it as my characters would have experienced it only from a place of much greater privilege. I don't want to talk too much longer because I wanted to give you time to ask me a few questions. And I want to be sure that we've got plenty of time left over for our other authors to speak, and I will definitely be listening to the recording of this to listen to their pieces since I need to finish packing. But is there anything in particular you would like to ask me or you'd like me to speak more about in regards to the book? And there's many themes running through it. I'm trying not to give away too much.
Just raise your hand and we'll call you out if you have a question. Go ahead. I want to recognize Ruth Linderman, who's actually a survivor from Vienna. To Ruth. So welcome back, Ruth. Go ahead, ask your question.
Jennifer, you talk very quickly, and I know you have to get done, but what was the name of the book?
Exile Music?
Exile Music?
Yes, I can type it into the chat. It's also behind, I don't know if you can see, maybe my window's small, but if you make it on speaker view, you can probably see the book. It's behind me in my background.
All right, I will do that.
And I just texted, I wrote the title in the chat.
And let me just say, Anne Gorski, welcome. But you have shared your screen accidentally. So if you can stop the screen share I can then use the tools that I have. So thanks, Anne.
Thank you, Jennifer. I just wanted to make sure because I do want to get it. And I assume it's available by now.
It is. It's available. It's available anywhere you can get books. You may have to, I mean, it's available online or you can ask a bookstore to order it. But yes, it's available.
Okay. I wrote a book called We Chose Survival, which tells my story from the time I'm 5 years old in Vienna in 1938-39.
Wow.
I was under the Nazis for about 2 years, and we talked often about going to Bolivia. It was one of the choices, Argentina, but we wound up in the United States, fortunately, but I do have friends who live there. So the breathing situation was one of the things that was a real challenge, and I'm glad you brought that up, and I'm looking forward to reading your book.
Thank you.
Right,
and I'm apologies for speaking so quickly. It's not because I have to go. I often speak too fast, and I'm sorry, but I can slow down.
Just want to make sure that everyone who's speaking today knows that most of the people who are with us are also authors. So literally, and I'm looking here, has some relationship to authorship. So it's really great. I have a question for you, maybe more than one. You have a globe behind you and I'm geographically challenged. So can you point to where Bolivia is? And I'm hoping Anne gave me back the screen. So
right with my finger, hang on. It's hard. There, Bolivia's.
Oh, shoot.
It's next to Brazil. It's right there. See it?
Not yet.
Right there.
Anne Gorse, can you please stop your screen share? Can you hear me, Ian? You somehow hit screen share. But
I hear you, but I don't know how to do it.
So it says stop screen share on the very top of your screen.
It says share contact.
Yeah, and then it says stop screen share.
I don't see that. It says screen.
And then right to the right of that, it says stop screen share.
Hey, Jeff, we're not seeing her screen on our end. So I don't, is she sharing her screen?
I see it on my side.
That's strange.
I don't see it either. Yeah.
I'm going to try to share my screen and then I'll stop sharing because it's letting me share my screen. And then I'll stop share. Did that fix it for you, Jeff?
No. Which is really strange. This is a new one for me. All right.
We'll just,
go ahead.
Yeah, I don't
know. All right. So where did you point? I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah, I have to do it again. It's just because of the screen, I can't.
Okay. All right. I'll look it up.
There it is.
I wanted to let people know, since we have done, Jennifer and I have done an obligation of memory interview series, which is available on YouTube. And I really want just to take a few seconds before we will go to the next presenter to tell them about your first book and how you and what happened to you in that period. So I think it's exceptional.
Okay, sure. So my first book came out of my experience running a newspaper in Yemen. I moved to Yemen in 2006 and started off training Yemeni reporters and was offered the job running the newspaper. So I became the editor-in-chief of a newspaper in Sana'a, Yemen, and worked, my whole staff was Yemeni. And I had the most incredible, challenging, exciting year training and learning from these Yemeni journalists. And I thought, I want the rest of the world to know these Yemenis I'm working with. Because in the US at the time, all you ever read about Yemenis were that they're terrorists. But of course there was, that was not the truth. Certainly not what I discovered when I was there. And so I had a very happy 4 years in Yemen. With a couple of minor incidents. But that's why I wrote, my first book is the story of my time at that newspaper and what I learned from my reporters, what I learned about Yemen, what I hope they might have taken away from me. I'm still in touch with all of them.
The name of your book, the name of the book?
That book is called The Woman Who Fell from the Sky.
The title is what?
The Woman Who fell from the sky. It's a line from a, I'll type it. It's a line from a Yemeni poem about a woman who fell from the sky and became the city of Sana'a.
And what was the experience that you haven't told us right now? Because I think it's important for people to understand who you are as a person.
Okay. So I met my husband in Yemen and we had a child, but while I was pregnant with this child, I was kidnapped. Is this the experience you want me to talk about, Jeffrey? Okay. So yes, when I was 6.5 months pregnant with my daughter, I was hiking in the mountains with 4 other women and we were kidnapped by a local sheikh. And there were 8 men with AK-47s around us. And I don't know if you want me, you probably don't want me to go into the long version of the story, but we were held for a day, but it was one of the worst days of my life. And I was pretty convinced we were going to die. But during that time, I also started having premature contractions. So I was 6.5 months pregnant. And when I started having contractions, I thought the stress is bringing on premature labor. And if I give birth here, I'm going to lose the baby because it's too early for her to come out. And I'm in a country with no medical care. I am in the middle of the mountains. I was 40 years old, so I had no idea how this was going to go. But I thought, if I survive this, I don't want to lose the baby because I've panicked. So I need to find a way to calm down. Now, calming down has never been a particular strength of mine. But fortunately, during pregnancy, I did a lot of yoga and a lot of yoga breathing. And I thought, well, the only way I know how to calm down is to do yoga breathing. So I'll just do that and I will chant a mantra to my child, which was stay in, it's not safe out here. And I just did that until I calmed down. And by the time my husband, the Yemeni government and the British government had negotiated my release, I was fairly calm and we all managed to escape alive, which was pretty lucky because a couple of weeks earlier, 9 foreigners had been lined up and executed in the north of the country. Most Yemenis are not like that, I feel like I have to say.
All right, but, I wanted to get my brother from another mother. Saul has a hand up. So Saul, do you have a question for Jennifer?
Well, I'm just interested in all of her travels. Did you learn all the foreign languages in all the different countries that you frequented?
Well, I've done my best. I studied Arabic for 4 years while I was in Yemen. And I was fairly conversational in Arabic. And then we moved to Bolivia and I had to learn Spanish. And learning Spanish kind of erased my Arabic. And then we went back to London and then we moved to Uzbekistan. And so I was very busy studying Russian when COVID hit and I was evacuated with my daughter for a year and kept separate from my husband for a year. And then I came back here for a few months and then was evacuated a second time because I was diagnosed with cancer. And I had to spend 16 months in London alone, staying with friends while I went through chemotherapy and surgery before I could rejoin my family a couple of months ago. So my Russian, that's a very long way of saying, I haven't had time to learn Russian. I can say a few words, but I certainly didn't get to have the time here I'd hoped to have. And now we're leaving in the morning. So.
Well, now you've got to learn French.
Well, I already know French, thankfully. That was the one language I started with, so.
Well, thank God you survived and you're able to do what you're doing. God bless you.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it. And I will look for your books, too.
Yes. I'll point them out. And we do, I would advocate to it was a joyful several hours that I spent with Jennifer on the obligations interview. So they're all on YouTube. So I would recommend that you learn much more. You were saying something?
Yeah, I might have missed it. Did you write your memoir? You are talking about everything about life, trauma, love, birth, languages. C'est impressionnant. C'est impressionnant. Vous avez écrit vos memoirs. Did you write your memoir?
I've written one, but it's only about the 1 year I was in Yemen. I've drafted one about surviving cancer while traveling every month, but I haven't sold that one yet. So a work in progress, I guess.
And you can speak to Jackie because she spent a lot of time from her youth in Paris. So went to the Sorbonne, and studied at the Sorbonne, right, Jackie?
Yes, and currently I'm working on a project involving performing arts and how, for example, we can try to help people with a traumatic experience through music or through any other performing arts. Yes, it will be interesting to talk to each other. Mes compliments.
Yes, yes. You can find me online or Jeffrey has my email. I'm happy for him to share it with you, so.
Okay, thank you.
Great. So I'm going to we're going to segue to a piece of music. Josh Nilsson is going to be entertaining us for three pieces between the gaps here. So let me get started, and I will share my screen. Here. Hold on. Sorry.
We are gifts and we are blessings. We are history in song. We are hope and we are healing. We are learning to be strong. We are words. We are stories, we are pictures of the past. We are carriers of wisdom, not the first and not the last. The door of our door, knocky God left. Door by door, we protect this chain. From generation to generation, door by door, these lips will praise your name. Looking back on the journey that we carry in our heart, from the shadow of the mountain to the waters that would part, we are blessed and we are holy. We are children of your way, and the words that bring us meaning, we will have the strength to say. The door of our door, nagid kol lecha. The door of our door, we protect this chain. from generation to generation. Ador vador, these lips will praise your name. Generation to generation, ador vador, these lips will praise your name.
Okay, and our next speaker is Blima Lorber, and I'm going to hold on a second. So Blima is a professional journalist, a master's in Jewish culture. She's the author of a book called Brazilians in the Holocaust and in the Resistance Against the Nazis, Fascism. And she's publishing that book in 2023. She's working on it for several years. She's also the co-author of a book called David's 14 Lies that was published in 2012. Blima is a researcher on topics related to the Holocaust for the University of São Paulo and for Holocaust Voices. Blima searches documents and information about the survivors, victims, and families in periods before, during, and after the Holocaust. She also works for international institutions and administrates several social media groups related to the Holocaust. And I just found out today that one of those Holocaust groups has 47,000 members. So I want to welcome Blima to the group. Blima has been a longtime supporter, has done various programs with us already. So welcome, Blima, and please take it away.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you for all of you. I can see some of my friends here too. Especially thank you to Professor Maria Luisa Tuste Carneiro, my dearest professor, that does an amazing work about Holocaust in Brazil, keeping the memory alive. Thank you, Professor. I'm going to talk about the Jewish partisans. So I start sharing my screen with you.
There you go.
Okay, there is a myth that in Brazil that there was no there is a myth that there was no Jewish resistance. The Jews went like lambs, like sheep, to death. This is not true. We have to fight against this myth. We have to show that if there was resistance. When I say resistance in the Second World War, resistance was in two parts. I can say that was resistance was non-armed, which was religious, artistics, and falsification of documents. This was resistance because everybody's life was in a risk, and there was armed resistance. I am a very passionate about armed resistance, right? And there were Jewish partisan activities in Europe, here in yellow, with the borders in 1939 37, right? So every country that you see in yellow had Jewish resistance, right? This is us from Jewish Partisan Education Foundation, a foundation in the United States that it's really worth seeing their site and know more and more about Jewish resistance. Even in Germany, there was a small resistance. Italy had resistance, France had resistance, Yugoslavia, Bulgaria, Greece, Poland, Lithuania. Here you don't have Belarus, but there was resistance also in Belarus, right? There are groups that are quite well famous. The Bielski group is one of the most known groups, the Jewish group that was in Belarus, that had around 1,000 people, something like that. And the Bielski brothers have a movie that tells about their story. But there is another group that was well famous. It's called the Greenspan group. The Greenspan group is from Yehiel Shil Greenspan. This is Yehiel. This is Yehiel. And Yehiel was a trained soldier from cavalry. And he started a group in Poland, in Janów Lubelski, which is Lublin area. And this group started small, with seven people that joined Russian partisans. And after that, he created a Jewish group with military strength. He kept everything like a military man, right? Yehiel was very famous. He is very famous. There are many books about Jewish resistance talking about Yehiel Greenspan and the Greenspan group, which was very, very effective in fighting the Germans. In this group, we have his brother, Abraham, his sister-in-law, which was taken out from a labor camp in Poland called Adam Paul. And we have Viv Litvak, who was only 16 years old. Right? Those three came to Brazil. I have the happiness to meet the family of Yehiel Shil Greenspan and interview his wife. Sadly, both are dead now. And I had a very close relation to Tzvi Litvak, and he was called Batsan. He passed away 2 years ago, and I really miss him because I used to talk to him every week. He would call me, I would call him, and I would visit him at his home. This is Yehiel when he came to Brazil. He never told about what he has done, what was his group. His family never knew about what he has really fought. He was a real fighter, and he knew all the area. His family was quite well known. And after the war, he was in Hubieshov, which is also in Lublin region. And there he worked as a policeman, trying to get the children, the Jewish children that were given away, to be saved, right? But he suffered an assault, an attack, and decided to leave the country and came to Brazil, where he married, but never talked about it to his family. Here is Shil Greenspan, was part of his group. This is Tzvi. This is in Germany after the war, during a wedding, right? This is Wolf Litvak, Zev Litvak, the Patsan, the youngest from the group, which I really miss. I was always talking to him. he was he had a very important he was very important to the group, the Sugar Instrument group, because he was advised by a Polish friend to go to the forest, and because the Germans would take his family to the ghetto. So he decided to call Schilgrinspan and more five other friends, and they went to a forest in the night, in a rainy night, and found the Russian group, and they got together with the Russian group. So the idea of the partisans really came from Zev Litvak, or Wolf Litvak, which is named Vevali the Patsan. The Patsan means the boy, the little boy. And he learned to be a man from the day to night. He learned how to fight for his life. He said to his family when he was leaving, "I would rather die from hunger. I would rather die from fire, but Hitler will not kill me." I really miss him, right? This is another partisan who came to Brazil. This is Abraham Braun from the Braun Group. Okay. The Braun, he also came to Brazil. And this is Greenbaum that also came to Brazil. So this group was also in the Lublin area, right? They had fought against the Germans. They had family camp, a small family camp, but they were denounced and not too many survived. But they fought really fine. And I am also friendly with Brown's family, which I keep his memory alive. And you can see there were also women. Sorry. Go back. There were also women in the group, okay? So each group, partisan group, had a family camp, which they tried to keep lives alive, right? And the Greenspan group also had two family camps, but they were also denounced, and around 100 of them survived. The Bielski brothers were the ones who really got a big family camp, and nobody found them, and all the members of the camp survived. There is another part of the resistance. This was in Holland. Leo Veil was born in Germany, and when Hitler entered power, he could not study anymore in Germany. So his family sent him to Holland. In Holland, he started to work and then went to school. But after the Germans arrived, he could not anymore work. So he worked for the Jewish people. He tried to do the best things he could do. He would falsify documents for persons and transport them from Amsterdam to Paris. He himself went to Paris with a false document and started to work in a German company. And his documents saved around 100 people, including pilots, Allied pilots that were in Holland. And whenever the Germans caught the documents, they always saw the documents like the real documents. He was never kept. Sadly, he also passed away 2 or 3 years ago. I miss all those people. This is Stanislav Shlomo Meisner. Stanislav Shlomo Meisner was a survivor from the Sobibor Revolt. He was a youngster. You can see him in the movies about Sobibor. He was the goldsmith, and he survived and was with a Russian partisan group, and he said it was the best time of his life to be a partisan. He was free to do whatever he wanted for the first time in his life. It was the best time. He came to Brazil and he had a very important act because he was the one who went to see Gustav Wagner when Gustav Wagner was in jail in Brazil. And he was the one who recognized Gustav Wagner. Gustav Wagner was in Sobibor, and Schmeissner was also in the Franz Stangl process in Germany, right? So he was very, very important. Gustav Wagner killed himself. He didn't pay for his crimes. But Shlomo Schmeissner also passed away quite some time ago. But it's very important to know that he was a very important person in this area. Now we have Moshe Shutan. Moshe Shutan is the youngest boy here. He was 14 years old. He was in the Abakovner group in Vilnius. Shutan sadly passed away last year. I also had the privilege to talk to him, and he has also a wonderful story behind him, because he's like Zev Litvak, like the Patsan. He said he would not die in the hands of the Nazis. He would die fighting. And he lived a long life, 96 years old. And it's very important to know that there were partisans, so there was fighting, that there were at least 30,000 Jews that fought back the Nazis, usually youngsters, because they didn't have any experience. The older ones had some military experience, but those they didn't have experience, and they fought with whatever they had. They had only few ammunition, and they wanted really, really to save lives. This is what is called a fiche rouge, a red sign from France. It's called the Libération de l'Arme du Crime. This was posted by the Germans in France. And this group is called Misak Manouchian group. Misak Manouchian was an Armenian, but his group had all kinds of foreigners. At least 10 of them were Jews. You can see those pictures. They have the names of the people. They have from where they come from. And they have, especially for the Jews, they have the mention they are Jews, right? So you have here, Les Mémories de Rescapés, the Résistants du groupe Misak Manouchian. They were caught and they were killed on 21 February 1944. You can see some of the names are really Jewish. Raimon Bansik. Bansik was the only woman in the group. She was taken to Germany because in France they couldn't hang or kill women at the time. So she was taken to Germany, and 3 months later she was beheaded, right? You have Fingervik, you have Weissbrot, you have Grasch, you have Griswak, you have Goldberg, you have Geduldig, you have Wirtig, and there were some others, right, from Masonry here. They were killed, but their memory stays alive. I received this week information that Macron, the president of France, wants to put Misak Manouchian in a place where all the heroes of France are taken, right? So this is really important to know that the resistance was also by foreigners with Jews. Pia Schumann was a woman that was also a fighter. She was a photograph, right? And she was kept alive by the Nazis because they needed her work. After she did some work for them, and she ran away and joined a Russian group, and she took pictures from all the what was there. She had to hide her Jewish background, but she did quite a wonderful work. There is a book called The Partisan Memoir, Women on the Holocaust, where she wrote and she puts all the pictures. Her gun was a camera. She would hide her gun. She would bury her camera and then unbury it so she could take pictures. Faye Schumann lived in Canada. After she passed away, was 101 years old. But her memoir is so very, you have to read it, right? This is the Jewish Partisan Inn that most of you know. So we are going to listen to it. Take some time.
We're not hearing it, Blima. So I want to give you a suggestion. Can you stop your screen share? Okay, now on the very bottom, stop your screen share. You just stopped the PowerPoint. Stop your screen share.
Just a minute. I think I stopped.
Okay, yes. Now start it again. But before you start your PowerPoint, on the very left of your screen share, you'll see a checkbox which says play video, play sound. And that's what's stopping the sound from going. So screen share again. All right, well, I don't want to make it hard on you. Just keep going, and then you only have three more slides, so let's skip this one and move on to the next one. I don't think it's
worth. I want to say that Hirsch Glick was a poet in the Vilnius ghetto, right? And he was only 22 years old when he was killed in Latvia. He was caught in Vilnius. He ran away. And then he was caught in Latvia and they killed him. Can you hear it?
No.
No.
No?
Why don't you go to the next
slide? Yes, I do. I do hear perfectly.
Okay. I don't
the
hear.
Sound?
No.
No, we
Does
hear.
Does it take some time before it starts?
No. Why don't you skip it? So we'll go on to the next slide. I'm sorry.
Next one is also a song. It's Bella Ciao. Is from the Italian Partisans. You might know Primo Levi as a partisan, well-known writer, who was also Jewish and a partisan. And Bella Ciao is an Italian hymn about partigiani italiani. And what you see here, you see the red from communist, but here you see a trunk of a tree being cut. That in Italian is called fascis, fascis. And from here, you got the names as fascism, fascist, because fascist meant in the Roman Imperial power. And this group was against this type of thing from Mussolini. So I don't know if you can listen to.
I can help you. Hold on a second.
Okay.
La mattina sono alzato,
well, it's not so well, but this song has been known nowadays with a Netflix show called House Paper House or something like that, but it's really a partisan hymn, Italian partisan hymn. Okay, so let's go ahead. Talking about partisans, we have this young boy called Franco Cesana. He was the youngest Italian partisan, one of the many partisans of Jewish faith, right? He was only 13 years old. He was a courier for the older order holders and died during a battle in Bologna between Germans and partisans. In the week that he was going to his house, he wrote his mother, he gave her message that he was going to spend his 13th big birthday at home. He never got there alive. She received his corpse exactly when he was going to be 13. There is a plaque dedicated to Susanna in Turin. You can see, and it's very touching that such a young boy gave his life for freedom, for liberty. And I think we have to remember those people, those youngsters that fought against the Nazis. Thanks to them, many of us are alive.
If you could take your screen share off, that'd be great. Okay, and thank you so much, Blima. Blima and I also got to know each other at a much lovely level through our obligations of interview series. And what Blima educated me on was the partisans. And I thought it would be great for the first time that we bring Blima and her program and her research to our group and have it recorded so we can stream and let the world know that yes, Jews did not just go to the slaughter without a fight. So thank you, Blima. And I want to ask anybody and everyone to, if you could put on your camera so we can see you. I want to open up any questions anybody might have for Blima. Please raise your hand and you can ask your question. Okay, and it's nice to see more people coming on with their screens. But I do have a question for you before, if anybody does. Oh, we have Judith up there. So Judith, unmute yourself and please ask your question.
Lima, would you like me to sing the first verse of Zog Nicht Kein Mo? Because I could sing it right now. I'm not warmed up or anything, but you know,
Go for it, Judith.
We should have it, you know, together.
Okay. And let me just say that Judith has presented several times with her lovely music. And she did a program with Zola Schumann for the Yom HaShoah group, Yom Programming in 2023. So she will entertain us go ahead and take the...
I'm not warmed up, so doing this very just from the need of Zagnit Kane Mulas du Kestem Letzten Bay, Koshin and Lion of Fashel and Goy Tay, Come and Vet Nochans are always kept to show. Sveta Poiton and the truck design and da, Come and Vet Nochans are always kept to show. Sveta Poiton and the truck design and da. Never say that you're going your last way, although the skies filled with lead cover blue days. Our promised hour will soon come. Our marching steps ring out. We are here.
Very nice. And I see that someone who has a name of Lorber has just joined us. Maybe you can say hello to, it's, I don't know, how do you pronounce, is it Zija Lorber? Do you see?
Zija Lorber.
Yeah, and you maybe-
my brother.
Maybe you want to introduce him, and your brother should go and unmute and say hello to you.
Let's see him. I can't see him.
He's right here on the very low, on the very bottom. Look for, raise your hand again so your sister can find you.
Oh, there.
Okay, and who's behind you? Who's behind your brother?
It's his son, my nephew.
Okay, terrific. And where are they?
She is the co-author of our father's book, The 14 Days, 14 Lives of David, The Boy with the King's Name, right? Okay. Which was the introduction by Professor Maria Luisa Tucci Carneiro, who was also the strength behind my thesis at the University of São Paulo, which I thank her very much for her being so close to me and keeping me alive in this subject. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Tucci. Thank you, my brother.
Maybe your brother can take his son, and his son can get unmute the screen so we can hear, we can talk to him.
Unmute, Bear. He doesn't speak English.
Maybe you can speak to him in Portuguese.
Then I don't. Abre o teu microfone.
Oi. Hello.
Good afternoon. It's nice to meet you.
Hello, everybody.
Maybe you can translate.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Faz uma pequena apresentação.
Para mim fazer a apresentação?
Maybe you can ask
uma pequena apresentação. Você é coautor do livro e tal.
Well, I'm the core writer of the book. I'm a journalist in Curitiba, State Paraná, South Brazil. That's it.
Very good. And maybe you can ask Maria to come on screen in Portuguese so she can say hello to us too.
Doutora Tucci, I think she left.
Oh, she's here. She's here. She's right here.
Okay, professora Tucci, uma palavrinha sua, por favor.
Pediu alguém para traduzir.
So tell her to use her, go on video.
And pode apresentar, pode entrar com vídeo, professora Tucci?
Acho que ela saiu.
Acho que ela, I think she left, her name is not here.
Okay, I see it here, but that's okay. It's a pleasure to have you on board with us and to enjoy you and to hear your sister speak. So thank you for coming. And thank
Sorry
you.
For my English, it's been quite some time. I didn't practice it,
perfect.
But I got the message for you, right? We had resistance. There is a myth that we have to fight that the Jews did not resist. There were at least 16 partisans who came to Brazil. I am writing about their life stories in a collection called Holocaust Voices from Professor Dulce Carneiro. I am the one responsible for the resistance part. So I'm very happy that I can do it and meet their families.
Yes, and can you stand up for a second, Blima, and tell us what's behind you?
Behind me, you have the first, it's the inside of the first synagogue of America, which is in Recife, Pernambuco, in the northern part of Brazil, which has renewed. So from here, this was from Dutch invasion to Brazil. And after the Portuguese took the Dutch away, this group that was in this part of Brazil went up there to create New Amsterdam, which is now New York.
Interesting. Okay, is there...
I hope you visit it someday, because Brazil has a lot of Jewish roots in the northern and the south part. We have Sfaradim and we have Ashkenazim. Sfaradim in the north and Ashkenazim in the south.
I'm sorry, I forgot something important. I came in this minute in home and I forgot. I'm the president of Heim Weizmann Lodge from Neybri, Paraná, Curitiba.
So very good. Thank you and congratulations. All right, I'm going to again set up soon. We'll hear from Keith. And but before that, I'm going to share my screen.
God is my God, and my God is everything. Aren't we all, aren't we all part of one God? Let your God be my God, and our God be everything. Oh, we're all, no, we're all part of one God. So open up your heart to all the lost and lonely. Let no
let no one be alone tonight.
Okay, and next to present is Keith Newhouse, and I'm going to give you a brief write-up on Keith. Hold on a second. Keith is the author of the RPLA-winning children's book, My TO's Pulse, and the CEO of the Newhouse Creative Group. Keith is a senior systems designer and specializes in creating efficient and productive workflows. He's also the senior instructional designer and creates innovative and engaging online graduate courses. He's also the CEO of NewhouseCreativeGroup.com. So welcome, Keith. And I also want to say that this is Pride Month, and I'm really happy to have an inclusive group here at JCHR, and representing Pride is Keith. So Keith, why don't you take it away and share your screen and get started. Thanks.
Will do. Thank you so much, Jeff. It's great to see everybody today. Give me 1 second. I'm going to share my screen. All right. Can you all see my PowerPoint?
Yes.
Perfect. So yes, it is Pride Month. Jude is Pride Month. I am a member of the LGBT plus community. First of all, thank you everybody for being here today. I'm going to talk to you about my book, My TO's Pulse, but more I want to talk about the idea of healing through stories, and specifically talk with children and adults about pulse remembrance. When the pulse tragedy happened in 2016, we're now at the 7-year anniversary of that. And this is a project I worked on with a number of individuals from Orlando and across the country even, which we'll talk about in a minute. Yeah.
Since we have a worldwide audience, perhaps you can explain the pulse situation and what happened there a little more.
Absolutely. And we'll talk more about this in the presentation as well, but there was a shooting at a LGBT plus nightclub in Orlando on Latin night, and 49 people were killed. And we just hit the 7-year anniversary on June 12th. Thanks. All right, so a little about myself first. I'm from Long Island, New York. I live in Orlando now, though. I'm the first generation American. My dad is actually on this call as well, Mark Newhouse, which we'll talk more about in a minute. I'm half Jewish, half Protestant. As Jeff said, I'm a senior learning designer. I work for Wiley, and I design online graduate courses for colleges across the country, work with faculty to get their courses from a face-to-face class, usually to an online version, and try to make more engaging and interesting for the students. I am also an entrepreneur and publisher. Dad and I started the Newhouse Creative Group together about 4.5 years ago, which we'll talk more about as well. I am the author of My TO's Pulse. And for fun, I do a ton of musical theater performance, as well as writing and producing for the musical theater scene in Central Florida. And I take part in a lot of philanthropy. And of course, I am a dachshund owner, or I'm owned by a dachshund, and I'm not gonna let you get away without seeing her. So of course, that's my beautiful Bella, my supermodel dachshund. A little about my family. In order to understand more about me and why I do what I do, we have to understand my family. My dad, Mark, is on this call, as I said, and my mom, Linda. I don't know, dad, is Linda, is mom around there somewhere? Okay, well, I am first generation American. My mom is English. If she was here, you'd hear her English accent.
She's
my
right
dad,
here. Keith, oh. She's right here.
Hey, mom. All right.
Go ahead.
Yes, my mom is English. My dad is... his family's from Poland, and he was born in Germany. And then you can see my brother, who's actually my half-brother from my dad's first marriage, but we've been so close our whole lives, we just call each other brother, and he's in that picture with us as well. I am half Jewish, half Protestant, hence the Christmas tree picture. I just told dad the other night, I'm like, we need a good picture from a menorah, because we don't have a good picture of the three of us in front of a menorah. But having grown up Jewish and Protestant, they raised me to be what we call tolerantism, being tolerant of all religions, all people, as long as you're a good person and try your best. They also taught me the importance of customs and history growing up. So we did have Christmas every year. And of course, my dad took part in that with us. And we also celebrated Hanukkah. We still do to this day, as many times as I can. I love doing FaceTime with my parents and singing the menorah prayers each Hanukkah. my grandparents, at the top, you see my mom with her parents. They moved to America when my mom was 18. My grandma was from England and my grandpa was from Wales. My dad's parents in the bottom picture there with myself and my brother and my dad. They are Holocaust survivors from the Lodz ghetto and then German concentration camps. And they moved to America after World War II when dad was a year and a half old. Dad does an little shameless plug for my dad here. He has an amazing presentation also on the website called Taming My Monsters. If you're interested in that, I highly recommend checking that out on the website, Messages from the Holocaust. That's a picture of my dad with his mom and dad.
That was about 2 years and several months after they were freed from Auschwitz and Buchenwald. And look how thin they were. I mean, it absolutely amazes me. How they survived, I'll never know.
So growing up, because of our past, because of our family's past, giving up has always been, giving back has always been very important to us. We always consider ourselves very lucky. When I was young, we didn't have a lot, but we had a lot to give back. I remember as a kid, we went to the food ministry every Thanksgiving and we would serve food to the homeless. Mom would take one little box of mashed potatoes, the instant mashed potato mix, and she would have what's called the miracle of mashed potatoes, where it would just make tray after tray after tray after tray of potatoes that we would give back to the feed the homeless. That continued to my adulthood. I've done over the years a lot of work with the Second Harvest Food Bank of Central Florida. We participated in an event called Can Structure Orlando, where structures are built out of canned food. Really cool. If you get a chance to check out the Can Structure website, highly recommend it. And then all that food is given back to the food bank to feed the homeless and hungry. I also took part in Relay for Life with the American Cancer Society. I was the chair of a number of different Relay for Life events around Central Florida. And I was on the board of directors for Central Florida Vocal Arts and Opera Group, where we had a children's summer camp that would teach children to love opera and the performing arts. And we gave scholarships to the students as well. So I helped raise money and helped pick the scholarships for that program. So all this giving back that started with my parents has continued to my adult life. From that, my dad and I have created a publishing company called Newhouse Creative Group. For years and years, dad ran this publishing company as a hobby. And he kept saying to me, take it over, take it over, take it over. I said, no, 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 no. I love my job. I love what I do in designing online graduate courses. But I thought about one day how much good I could do with a publishing company. So dad and I have been doing this for about 4.5 years now. Every one of our books, we try to give back either through education or through financial or sometimes both. Some of our books, these are the ones that we give back financially with, a couple of them. So one is Coronavirus, one of our authors. And we have, I think, 22 authors now with over 40 something books. But one of our authors, Christine Borst, we donated a large portion of the profit from that book to help with coronavirus research when that was going on. Super Buds helps children in the Ocala forest with literacy. The Luke the Lost Duckling, we give back a portion of the profits from that to Chapman University's Loon Project. So that's something that was really important to us in starting a publishing company. We also have a really nice Jewish division of the company now, which also gives back educationally. But all these books are written by my dad. My Family Secret is a teenage book about the Holocaust. It teaches at a young adult level a safe way to teach kids about the Holocaust. We have Dreidel Dog that teaches kids about Hanukkah. We've also donated copies of Dreidel Dog as well as dreidels to local schools in the Central Florida area to teach them about Hanukkah. And The Devil's Bookkeepers is my dad's award-winning book, Book of the Year from Florida Writers Association, a whole bunch of other awards it's won. But it teaches about the Lodz ghetto during the Holocaust. And again, if you want to learn more about that, dad's presentation is absolutely fabulous.
Boy, I got to pay you as my publicist.
So when the whole tragedy happened, June 12th, 2016, it affected everybody in Central Florida, but especially as a member of the LGBT plus community, I got text messages that morning going, are you okay? Are you okay? Are you okay? I'd only been in the Pulse nightclub once, but because I'm a member of that community, I had many friends text me and find out if I was okay. My first thought when it happened was, what can I do to help? After September 11th, I was in New York. It was my second week of college, and my dorm room looked out at the Twin Towers. And seeing that happen and watching the buildings crumble in slow motion, when I left New York and moved to Florida, I thought, this is never going to happen to me again. So when Pulse happened, it really brought everything closer to home again. So I wanted to find out what I could do to help after it happened. I contacted the food bank that I was doing a lot of work with at the time. I said to them, what are you guys doing? And they go, we just don't know what we're doing yet. So a few weeks later, my opera group contacted me and said, we're doing a concert called Beautiful Together. And with this concert, we had 40 different groups from Orlando all get together and perform to raise money for victims and their families, as well as just bring a little bit of joy back into the community after such a horrible tragedy. As you can see, I'm the little blue arrow there. That's me singing with my opera group and with, I think it was 300 other performers from all over the Central Florida area. So that was just a great way for me to give back a little bit, but I wanted to do more. When Pulse first happened, I spoke to my manager at work about it. She's one of the best parents I know. She's a former teacher. So everything she does for their kids is lesson plan based. So like when the Olympics come around, she does a Greek night where they have Greek food and they talk about Greek mythology and all the gods, and just everything with her is so educational. So I asked her, how are you going to tell your kids what happened at Pulse? And she said to me, I just don't know. If a parent that good doesn't know what to say, how is the normal parent going to know what to tell their kids about such a horrible tragedy or any kind of tragedy, really? So I came up with this idea to write a book about the Pulse tragedy, but also about how to talk to kids about tragedy. I told a marketing friend of mine about it while I was working on another marketing project with her. And she goes, you have to do this. And I said, I don't know what I'm doing. I've never written a book before. Maybe 5 years from now, I could do this once I have more experience working with other authors. Maybe I could do it. I just wouldn't even know where to start. And she goes, it doesn't matter. You need to do this now. So she put me in touch with the Orlando United Assistance Center, Joel Morales. And we told him about the idea for the book, and he loved it and said he wanted his organization to be involved with it. This organization helped victims of victims and their families from the Pulse tragedy, giving them mental health help with it, trying to give them financial health help with it. But it was just such a great organization to be involved with, to get the project rolling as well. And then she also introduced me to Kenny Teo on the right here, who is a psychotherapist who worked with children who were affected by Pulse. So maybe their brothers were killed at Pulse, maybe their uncles were there, their aunts. And just, he gave us the right words of how to tell kids what happened. He said that an unsafe person hurt people is the best way to tell kids what happened at that tragedy, and in tragedy in general. The synagogue killings in Pittsburgh not long after the Pulse tragedy, same kind of thing, an unsafe person hurt people. Those were the words he really just wanted to express to me to get across the point to kids about what happens at tragedies. I was also connected to Ethan Long, who is an author and illustrator over 100 children's books, including the Scribbles and Ink series that he has a deal with PBS cartoon series with them. Amazing guy, but he said there's no way he could do it. He just didn't have the time for it. But he had an idea to connect me with other illustrators in the area. While I was working with Ethan, I had a dream one night. Because I didn't have, I knew that I wanted to tell the story. I didn't know how to tell it yet, though. So I had a dream about a kid who took his pulse in class. He learned how to take his pulse in class and then told his uncle about it. And his uncle was actually at the Pulse tragedy, and it triggered him to remember what he went through at the tragedy. I wrote down a whole draft of the project. I wrote down the first draft of the story, and I sent it to Ethan. And Ethan comes back with, this is garbage. He actually said it in much less nice terms, but he said, we're going to make this an incredible story. So between him and my dad looking over the book and editing it with their experience, we came up with the first draft of the book. Ethan also had this great idea at this time to have multiple illustrators for the book. So he connected me with the Orlando Giant Illustrators Group, and we ended up with 22 different illustrators working on the book with us. Each page of the book has a different illustrator, and each page has a different style. We were also connected with Blue Star from the Come Out with Pride organization in Orlando. They organize our Pride event. Good friend of mine, and she found out about my book and said, we have to do this at Pride. So before, we didn't have any kind of deadline for this. Now we had a deadline of 2 months to get this book done. She said she wanted to do a drag queen story time on a grassy lawn with, I figured, like 12 kids sitting around drag queen, not a big deal. So I could just create a Kindle version of the book that students that the drag queen could read to the kids, and we could have maybe a pre-order for the book. Not a huge deal. It's a bit of a timeline still to get the book done, but I wouldn't have to worry about printing, which is something that really takes a long time with Amazon, who I do my printing through. We started get illustrations back from the illustrators. We got sketches first. We came back with feedback to them. They made drafts of them for us. And it was just incredible seeing how many different styles all these different illustrators had and all the different interpretations they had for this book. It was just beautiful seeing how it all came together. But if any of you know what it's like working with illustrators or artists in general, I also do a lot of musical theater, as I said, it is like herding cats to get these kind of creative people together. In the meanwhile, we also heard from Karen Brown, who was the head of the Pride Committee. And she contacted me saying that, no, we're not going to do this on a grassy knoll with 12 kids sitting around drag queen. We are going to do this on the main stage right before the main event of Pride, with the giant jumbotron screen displaying our illustrations. We are also going to do an autograph session at the Pride launch party to launch the book. And I said to her, well, why do you want me to autograph it? In the midst of all of this craziness, I'd forgotten I was the author, and I felt like a project manager just trying to get all the artists all together. And it reminded me that I was also the author of the book. So now we not only had to worry about getting it on Kindle, but we had to get print copies of the book. And as much as excited as I was to have this going on, I'm going, how the heck am I going to get print copies of this book in, I believe by this point, it was like 3 or 4 weeks. So I contacted 40 different printers in town, and every single one of them almost came back with me saying, this is impossible. You're never going to get it done. It is never going to happen. We can't do this. I had 2 or 3 companies come back and say, all right, we could do this, but it's going to cost you a heck of a lot of money to do this. Then I had Lynn and Lee from Fine Line Printing and Graphics come back, and they say, this is such an incredible project. We need to be involved with this. We will do this. We will make sure this happens, and it's going to be at cost of the paper only. They didn't charge me for labor. They didn't charge me for ink. They said for the entire history of this project, from whenever I started printing it till whenever I finished printing it in the future, they are going to do it at cost for this book. That's how much they love the project. And it was like something amazing was happening every day. Everything was coming together, and we got to present it at Pride with Miss Sammy, one of the most prominent drag queens in town. She's since passed away, sadly, but she was absolutely incredible, did a great reading of it. We had so many people at the presentation. We had media coverage of the event. We were named Watermark, one of the newspapers in town, their best of 2018. We had news from all over Central Florida, as well as from Puerto Rico contacting us. Family Equality Council made us their book of the month at one point. It was just so nice to see this whole project come together, as well as be able to give back so much. We donated every cent of profit from this book back to Victims of Pulse and their families, and the One Pulse Foundation, and the Orlando United Assistance Center. But more than that, we saw how this book was giving back to individuals. We were teaching kids as well as adults what happened at Pulse tragedy, but also how to feel safe about tragedy in general, how to talk about their feelings, how to find somebody who's trusted to them, and how to ask questions. We had just such good feedback from huge people in the community. Mayor Buddy Dyer came up to me and thanked me for the book. Myra Alvear was one of the parents of the deceased from the Pulse tragedy, and she just loved the book. We had House representatives coming up and talking about it. And it was just so nice seeing how it was helping heal not just children, but adults in the community as well. I had the most amazing story I had from the Pulse, from the Pride weekend, was one really burly guy came up to me and he says, he opens the book to this page and he goes, "You see those lights? That was me. I worked at Pulse doing those lights." And he said the book has just affected him so much because he didn't know how to deal with it after it happened. He was there so many times for so many years doing all this work for the Pulse nightclub that he hadn't been able to process it. And this book helped him process what happened. This is my whole team that I worked with. Ethan, as I said, had worked on 100 plus children's books before this point. And even he was not a member of the LGBT community. He contacted me one night and he goes, "I gotta tell you, I'm not a person who gives back. I've never been somebody who volunteers for things. I've never been somebody who makes huge donations to things, but this project has changed me." And he was just so affected by the whole process that it really just was amazing seeing this community project come together. I still get a little verklempt when I think about how many people gave their time, their talent, their services to make this project happen, and how much healing we were all able to do together from the project. Even 7 years later, it's still affecting people. We've come up with partnerships with a whole bunch of different organizations where we're able to help heal more people through this. The Love Speaks exhibit at the Orange County History Center, they put us in their exhibit to help people heal through art. They put a bunch of our illustrations in to show how much healing has happened through art and how to heal through art even more. We're also in their virtual exhibit, if you're interested. That's a really cool thing to see online. If you go to their website, you can see how the whole exhibit was laid out in a 3D environment. Really cool. We're on display at the Downtown Orlando Visitor Center to welcome people to Orlando and show them about our history. We now have an official partnership with the One Pulse organization that will be on display in the museum and the memorial when they are completed. I was also in talks with the Kennedy Center at one point in DC about a Theater for Young Audiences production. They came to me and said, "We want to do a Theater for Young Audiences production." In the talks, they became too busy for it at the time, but I'm working with a team to come up with a musical version for children that I want to present to them, and hopefully we'll be able to get them to talk about for the 10th anniversary, maybe do a production of it for the 10th anniversary in a couple of years. If I go to them and say, "We've got this completed," maybe they'll be more open to actually producing it at that time. The biggest thing is we want people to know that it's still okay to talk about. It's still okay to talk about your feelings. And unfortunately, a lot of what we're seeing now is going in the opposite direction, especially in places like Florida. We have what has been coined the "don't say gay law" now, where it's not being okay to talk about things like Pulse. The Washington Post had an article a couple months ago before the law was put into place, where Teresa Jacobs, the former mayor of Orange County and the president of the school board, said that the law, if put in place, was really going to hurt children, including banning my book, my Tio's Pulse. So I'm really excited. I hate that it happened, but I'm really excited that we're part of that fight to try to make it okay to talk about these things again, make it okay to talk about LGBT+, make it okay to talk about tragedy, okay to talk about even Jewish history is being erased in a number of places. And make it, we're part of this fight to make sure it's okay to talk about all these things to children, because they have to be talked about. Thank you so much. This project has been so healing to so many people, including myself. And it just helps me so much to be able to talk about it with you all And I really thank you all for being a part of this with us.
Well, I want to have you take your off share screen. We'll go back on the gallery. Well, first, I have a few things I have to say before I open up to questions. And I'm going to start with Mark. Mark and I have become such good virtual friends. Mark has presented and is a huge supporter of the group. And Mark provided the introduction to Keith. And Keith has joined our Havara, which I don't know whether you even know that we have a small group of Havara that we meet every few months. Keith, you have presented something that is so special. I am so honored that I have found you and that you could bring a program like this to our group and that I can stream it everywhere. So thank you again. Your presentation was just as vibrant as you are. And I love your orange shoes or pink shoes that you had in one of the slides. I knew that it definitely fits perfectly. And so I knew the next person that would come after me would be my pal from San Diego, Jackie Gamache. And so Jackie, I could see that you have so many questions and you are so in sync with Keith that I gotta believe.
I'm holding it.
Go ahead,
Mark.
You know, you deserve so much compliments individually. And I see it, I feel it, but I see also your project as from generation to generation. I don't know, there is a grandchild coming up and put him in a company. Don't hesitate. I wanted to share with you, I have one question and one comment. Many years ago, many decades ago, the Sim Museum of Jerusalem had done an exhibit called Coexistence. Coexistence, does it sound okay in English?
Yeah.
Right? And I respectfully, very respectfully suggest that you look at it because they are reviving this exhibit and it's a together story and it's illustrated with arts and with a full educational program. Just to share with you. But can you tell us a little bit more about the Pearls Foundation?
Yes, I'm not associated with them. We have a partnership with the One Pulse Foundation. I know they're going through a lot of changes at the moment, but they're working to create a museum and memorial to the Pulse victims and also to be able to educate about what happened at Pulse. A lot of the things we talk about in the book, what happened at Pulse and how to cope with tragedy in general and just bring the community together. It's Orlando United Assistance Center that I started the project with has gone out since then. They've become incorporated with the, I believe it's the United Way. They're a part of the United Way now. So we've changed our partnership. So the money is all going to the One Pulse Foundation at this point.
Okay.
Right. I did do want to let everybody know, I put in the chat box that a little shameless plug. Newhouse Creative Group is giving away 10 audiobook versions of The Devil's Bookkeeper's Book One, which is Dad's book. If you want to visit our Facebook page, just leave a little comment on our post about it and you'll be entered to win one of those. I also put a link to My Tears Pulse on the Newhouse Creative Group website, as well as on Amazon if you're interested in it.
Okay. And I want to
Jeffrey, may I say something?
Not yet. One second. So Robert Wolf, Anne, and Diane, if you can come on, and we'd love to see you and meet you. And Robert is going to be presenting. We can talk about your book. So Robert, if you can come on, go ahead, Mark.
I just want to say, I feel like I went to a Keith's bar mitzvah here. It was absolutely, someone wrote that we should be very proud of him. I am definitely proud of him. And it brings up some of the themes we talked about today, which are the different kinds of resistance. You know, one of the things that really had bothered me in doing the research for the Devil's Bookkeeper series about the Ludge Ghetto was the way many people seem to think there was no resistance by Jews to the Holocaust and to what the Nazis did. And to me, what Keith is talking about is a different kind of resistance that is so important. And I guess someone said it in this group a while back, that the best revenge we have on the Nazis and Hitler is our wonderful children. And I really think that Keith is a crusader, and I'm just very proud of him, and I just want to say that. One more thing. We've talked in the past about reaching children, and we've not really talked about things like picture books, but it is something definitely worth considering, because we are not going to change people's attitudes once they get past a certain age. But teaching children about hate and what Keith calls unsafe people, I think is something that trans, it is so important. It really is. It's not about just the pulse nightmare. Like Keith said, it was about what happened in the synagogue in Pittsburgh and what's happening all over the world today. So I just wanted to add my two cents. Keith, you did a great job. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
Mom is too.
Yeah.
Why don't you get up and let mom come in so we can see mom? But you're hugging the seat.
Come over here. She's kind of shy.
Oh, come
here
on.
Here she is.
It's her son. Hi. Nice to
see
you.
She's floating in and out. Bye. Here, sit down.
That's fine. No.
The joys of Zoom.
All right. Well, are there any other questions for Keith? I want to, hopefully you'll stay with us. You're welcome to, obviously we're going to go over time, but I found a really beautiful emotive video that I want to share with you. It's called Joe's Violin. I think you'll enjoy it. So I'm going to share my screen and I hope that I'll be able to play it. So let's start. Hear it? I want to make sure you can hear it. Yes?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Good. You know, something about it. Yeah. Last time I played it, perhaps 8 or 10 years ago. As I got older, things got a little bit more and more difficult. And then it came the announcement for those people who have an instrument that they don't really use it anymore. How long can you live with memories?
WQXR, which is running the instrument drive.
It's very simple. You have an old instrument sitting around, drop it off. The instruments will be distributed to schools in New York City.
And it seems like every instrument has a story behind it.
My name is Kathy Dean.
My name is Hedy Stempler.
And I'm donating a clarinet.
Has been in our family for 50 years.
I'm donating a Roland EM15 keyboard.
My name is Joseph Feingold. I donated a violin, which I bought in a displaced persons camp back in 1947.
After the war and all the horrible experiences, you just wanted a violin? I mean, there was probably so much you needed. So what drove you to use your cigarettes for a violin instead of a winter coat or food or...
I was born in Warsaw on March 23rd, 1923. I had a violin as a kid. I delighted in learning about the strings, the tonality. Everything at that time, as far as my mother is concerned, revolved around music. My mother had a good voice. And very often,
I accompanied her on the violin. Music meant so much to us. And I played the violin until the beginning of the war. The Germans came September 1st, 1939. The Gestapo were going to arrest my father. My parents decided my father and I had to escape to Eastern Poland, which was taken over by the Russians. I left my mother and two brothers. I left the violin behind. Within days, the Russian Secret Service came, picked up all the kids, packed them into freight trains, and sent them to Siberia. And I was one of them. I was 17.
We came up with the number of 1,000, the instruments we thought we would receive. In the end, we got 3,000 instruments, 500 on the very first day. Trumpets, French horns, violins. This is Joseph's instrument here.
We're in the process now of placing these instruments in schools with our matching partner, the Mr. Holland's Opus Foundation.
The mission is to put instruments into schools. So we're like a conduit, you know, we're the middleman.
When I first heard about Joseph's violin donation, it did put a sense of responsibility of we have to find a home for this where this violin can continue having its voice.
In the poorest congressional district in the nation is Bronx Global Learning Institute for Girls. We accept girls on a lottery basis. They're from new immigrant families, South America, the Caribbean, Africa.
Every single student in the school learns how to play the violin from kindergarten, day one. 1, 2, ready, and. You know, there's a report card, there's homework. The violin program here is treated as any other subject area.
One of the things that led me to knowing that this school was a perfect fit for Joseph's violin is that the principal referred to the girls that she serves at the school as survivors. They come from all different backgrounds, but each one of them has her story.
We have very exciting news to share with you all today. Today we are receiving a very special violin. There's a man named Joseph, and Joseph is a Holocaust survivor. His hope is that it'll bring a similar happiness and comfort to a young life. And we are choosing one student to play on it during their time here at Big League. And the student that we have chosen, she really shows a unique ability to show her emotion through her violin. So we are so excited to announce that the student that we have chosen is Brianna.
My name is Brianna Perez. I'm 12 years old, about to be 13 in a month, and I'm currently in the 7th grade.
I've known her since she was in 1st grade, and it's just been amazing to see her grow up into a young lady.
I had a huge obsession when I was younger with Tinkerbell, and I kinda still do. She's like an independent, hardworking fairy. And she was chosen for something special. And I was chosen for something special too.
When she's playing the violin, she transformed herself totally.
It's like she's going inside of the music.
Family is everything. I live with my mom. My father, he lives like across town, I guess.
I didn't notice that she took my husband and my break so hard. Until one day that I saw her crying and she started playing the violin. And she told me that, I believe it's my fault. And I said, no, it's not your fault. It's not your fault.
Everyone has those days where it's like dark for them, but most people find their light. And my light is playing the violin.
Brianna has been presented with some challenges that here in the school, everyone has really assisted her to overcome.
It's such a joy to teach you every single day here at school. You display a passion for music that is very rare. We know, Brianna, that you will cherish this violin and enjoy playing on it just as Joseph did.
So happy for you. Joseph's going to be very excited.
You should invite him. He always wanted to be a survivor of the Holocaust.
We're hoping he can come. That would be really special.
Schubert's Polonaise for violin and orchestra. WQXR. Classical 105.9 FM. Time for your morning bop.
Suddenly, I found myself in Siberia, in a labor camp. Life was very tough. Temperature kept dropping. It was colder and colder. They allowed us to write a letter once a month. So I sent the letter to my mother, and I received a reply. My mother wrote out the lyrics of Solveig's song, which was very appropriate to a mother who is missing her son. I sang it. Yeah, I still remember it very well.
E, A, B, C, D, E, F, F, E, E, C, A, C, C, B, B, G, G, E.
It's amazing how we were chosen out of everyone.
It looks like a violin, but it's way more than that.
Inside, there's so many secrets, and that violin has so many secrets that nobody knows.
Now I can hide our secrets.
I cannot forget my brother telling us only once in our life about the day They took my mother and youngest brother in that train. That's the only time when he told me with details which I don't care to repeat. My brother and I went to the flea market, who came across the violin. So we got the violin for a carton of cigarettes. I walked the streets and I played the violin. It reminded me of my young years before the war. That was when I finally lived as normal as it could be. I arrived to the United States in 1948. In 1962, I became an architect. I met Regina in 1970. She knew my attachment to the violin, so the first gift I got from her was a music stand. Dear Mr. Feingold, thank you very much for donating your special violin. The first time I played on your violin, I loved the immersed and gorgeous sharp sound. I was also speechless when Miss Coco called my name. Music was made a huge impact on my life. I would love to invite you to PGLIG so I can meet you. I am thankful every day that I have the opportunity to play on your beautiful violin.
Every single day. This is my classroom.
That's where we're gonna go in?
Yes. You ready?
Sure. This is Brianna?
This is Brianna.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello. Oh. Couldn't think of... Oh, boy. You are beautiful.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm very, very happy. That's nice.
Thank you.
You're devoted to violin.
Yes, I am.
Oh, boy.
Thank you so much.
I'm really I was surprised that you find the violin so nice and sound.
It's beautiful.
I thought it was a violin.
It sounds more than a violin.
That's terrific.
Thank you.
Do you think I'll be able to hear?
Of course. I do have something prepared for you.
Oh, good. Very well. That was great.
Thank you.
How did you select this Greek piece?
Well, my teachers told me it was a piece that your mom gave you.
She
sent
me
a letter.
Oh, she sang this. She knew the words to it too. Oh yeah, that's terrific.
And it's very special to
me. That you have it. Oh yeah. I never expected anything that's going to happen.
Why not?
And to me, it was a very simple thing. I don't use it. Let someone else enjoy it. I didn't know it's to go to anyone like you.
Music has connected every single person here today. Thank you for sharing your story and for allowing every student here at Big League to continue on your journey.
Sometimes I wonder, do I really deserve it? What did I do?
You never gave up. That's what you did.
Yeah.
You had hope.
I'm in love with her. Good afternoon.
It's a privilege because I get to have history in my hands. And to me, this is like an adventure. I always wanted an adventure.
So I hope you enjoyed Joe's violin. It was absolutely beautiful. And I want to leave you there. We've gone long for the program, but thank you all. I know you have lots and lots of choices on things to do with your time, and that you spend your time here is just a pure honor that you're giving me. And I love putting on these programs. Thank you, Blima. Thank you, Keith. Thank you, Jennifer. Nice to see you, Devorah, who's a survivor. Sammy Steinman was also on here today, who's a survivor. Thank you for being with us. Ruth Linderman, also a survivor. And Bob, nice to meet you. And if you can get off mute, I'd like to introduce you to everyone.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Yes, and Bob, why don't take 2 seconds, just let everyone know who you are and your book.
I'm Rob Wolf. I'm a radiologist. I've been practicing radiology for 30-some years from Detroit, Michigan. My parents were both survivors. My mom was from Budapest, Hungary. My dad was from Deer, Hungary. My dad wrote his autobiography in the 1970s, pencil and paper, to typewriter, to computer, to disk. Flash forward, dad passed in 97, mom passed in 2016. Unfortunately, I took care of her affairs. I retired for a year. I went back to work. brought me to the disc that a historian friend handed me, my dad's autobiography. Now we're 2018. Flash forward 5 years later, we turned it into a wonderful biography. It's an adventure, amazing stories, miracles. Just like your last gentleman, the violinist, amazing survival stories. Dad escaped four times, cloak and dagger stories, arguing with armed Russian soldiers, forged papers, hiding places, friends you wouldn't expect to be, enemies wouldn't expect to be friends. The book's on the shelves at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C., I'm proud to say. I've done multiple podcasts and TV interviews, and we've won 2 book awards and counting. So we're doing okay with this, just getting going. I'm excited to share. I've got a little speech, and we can do a Q&A next month, I guess, if that's okay with you.
I'm glad you're here because it gives me the jumping point to say that our next program is on July 16th. Robert is one of the 3 presenters in the group. I'll start promoting the group event shortly. And thanks, Robert, for introducing yourself to the group as well. And
I promise I'll be better dressed, and I'll be at my own computer. So.
You could dress anyway. Very casual here. So thanks a lot. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Good to see all my friends. Love you all. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.